All right, I think we got like maybe a mile-ish of walking through the woods before we get to the tree. Better get moving. Whoa, look at that pair of three-toed footprints there. They're huge. Look at them compared to the size of my foot. Dinosaur must have come through here. Check out this sweet pond. Totally froze over. Some really pretty valleys here. I didn't realize this place had so much hillage to it. Damn, can you see that down there through the trees? That's the Connecticut River. I knew there was like an overlook here, but I didn't know it was gonna be this high up. It's real cool, actually. You know, like 3 months ago, I watched some hiking video where the guy started the video by going, you know what they say, sky's out, thighs out. And then he had his thighs out because he was just wearing shorts. And every time I shoot a video now, I just think about that. I just think, well, the sky's out, but my thighs, they're in. What am I doing wrong? Probably doesn't come across super well on the camera because of all the trees, but Connecticut River sure is looking mighty. Cool tree. Great pair of trees. Now that's a tree and a half, I tell you what. Look, tree, I'm cold too, but you don't see me shivering. You don't gotta be a drama queen about it. All right, we're on our way to the tree now. I took kind of a roundabout way so I could just show off this pretty little area I'm in here. Hey, PSA, if anyone ever breaks through the ice and you absolutely have to go out there yourself to save them and you can't like throw them a rope or a log or something, make sure you do it like this. And not like this. Because the first way, your weight is a lot more evenly distributed, so there's less pressure on the ice.
All right, it's tree time. I looked at the map and it's definitely a lot closer to the entrance of the park than I thought it was, so doing a little backtracking now. Definitely went a bit deeper into the woods than I had to.
Hey, check it out. This is really cool. It looks like some kind of animal, maybe a deer or something, tried to walk across this ice when it was less sturdy and just broke through on every step. And then once it got colder again, the ice kind of froze around the debris left from the deer breaking through the ice.
All right, we should be approaching our tree now, and I think that's actually it right there. Hell yeah, look at that guy. Oh, that's one gnarly looking tree.
First off, I should let you know, Eastern Red Cedar is straight up not a cedar. It's actually a juniper. It's just commonly called a cedar in English because when colonists arrived at Roanoke Island and saw it for the first time, They just assumed it was a cedar and the name stuck. But rest assured, it's a juniper.
This guy is a super common tree in this part of the country. Its native range is pretty much the entire eastern half of the United States, Canada to Florida. The wide range is mostly due in part just to how hardy the tree is. This bad boy can tolerate a huge range of temperatures and soil qualities. I even read that it handles wind so well that it was planted as a windbreak tree back in the 1930s to help combat dust bowl conditions in the central United States.
So I was hoping this might have some lower down branches so I could try to figure out if this is a male or female tree, but all the branches are up there so I can't quite tell. If they were down here, I could look for little blue berries that you'll see on the female tree, and then small little like pine cone things that hold the pollen of the tree that'll be growing on the males. But I just can't quite tell from here, and it doesn't look like there's anything on the ground either.
Never mind, it's a female. Here's a few of the smaller berries that I could pick off the ground when I get the sunlight. See, they look pretty similar to the juniper berries that are used in gin making, but rest assured, these are not the same. They're actually considered to be slightly toxic to humans. If I can mash these open, each of these holds a couple seeds, and the primary way that the seeds get transferred around is from animals, mostly birds and cedar waxwings especially, eating the seeds and then pooping them out somewhere else for the male trees to fertilize.
I actually read that it only takes 12 minutes for a seed to completely pass through the gut of the cedar waxwing and get deposited out on the ground somewhere. So this tree must really love those little guys.
Oh, and if you live in the eastern half of the United States and get allergies near the end of the winter, this might be the culprit. This is a pretty common allergenic tree. And like a lot of the trees I cover in this series, this guy has a long history of medicinal use in Native American cultures. The Blackfeet made a tea out of the fruit to help with upset stomachs and vomiting. The Cheyenne used the leaves to make a tea to ease a sore throat. Apparently a very useful tree if you're feeling under the weather. And it's also worth noting that the wood of the tree was burned for ceremonial use, like maybe for a sweat lodge, for example. Definitely an important tree in those cultures. Long history in construction too. The rot-resistant, sturdy wood saw use in everything from like furniture to coffins. I guess the smell of the wood even repels moths, which gives the lumber extra value in the construction of wardrobes and bureaus. Basically anything meant to hold clothes or fabric. Tree typically grows to around like 40 or 50 feet, so this one isn't too much taller than a regular tree, I would guess. Although the trunk is definitely quite a bit thicker. Also related to its height, though, is a little nickname for the tree that occasionally gets thrown around, the graveyard tree. Apparently the legend is that if you plant one of these at the same time that a person is born, the tree growing to a tall enough height to shade the person should signal that that person's life is at its end.
And that's about all I got for the Eastern Red Cedar. As always, thanks for joining me. Hope to see you next time.